December greetings and welcome to the Asian American and Asian Research Institute. Hope everybody had a great holiday weekend. Tonight, we're honored to have with us Professor Ying Zhu to discuss her new book, How to Win in China, Behind the Scenes of the World's Largest Movie Market, which was recently published earlier this year. Through fascinating vignettes, Dr. Zhu reveals the century-long relationship between Hollywood and China for the very first time. Professor Ying Zhu is Professor Emeritus of the City University of New York's College of Staten Island and the Director of the Center for Film and Moving Image Research in the Academy of Film at Hong Kong Baptist University. Dr. Zhu is the recipient of a fellowship from the National Endowment for the Humanities. She is the author of four books, including 2 Billion Eyes, The Story of China's Central Television, and tonight's talk, Hollywood in China, and both are published by the New Press. She is also the co-editor of six books, including Soft Power with Chinese Characteristics, China's Campaign for Hearts and Minds. Dr. Zhu is also the founder and chief editor of the peer-reviewed journal, Global Storytelling, Journal of Digital Marketing, Digital and Moving Images. If you are interested in Dr. Zhu's past ARRI talks, she actually has several available in the on our website and YouTube channel, and you can watch those after this presentation over the weekend. And please welcome Dr. Ying Zhu.
Well, thank you. And I'd like to, you know, of course, thank ARRI for inviting me to here to give the talk, and for Anthony to host the talk, to take care of all the logistics. So who for those who have yet to come across the book, you know, here's the jacket for you to at least admire the cover design. And so that's the picture. The book was almost 10 years in the making, and I kind of took my sweet time to obsessive compulsively comb through every single bit of research material, probably and very unlikely indulgence under, you know, the current sausage tuning, quantity-driven assessment culture of our academia. Fortunately, I was not under the stress of tenure and promotion, you know, been there, done that a long time ago. Although I did stress out my editor at the New Press, who had to tolerate a very prolonged process while rebuffing my demand to extend the word limit. The final product, though, still at a 370 page long, which is actually too long, is much leaner and lighter after I kind of grudgingly let go one third of the draft manuscript. And the unintended consequence of a prolonged process is that things do change when you let a decade pass by. So the idea of writing a book actually, you know what, let me go back to this. So the idea of writing a book that parallels the origin and evolution of the American and Chinese film industries and also the interactions between the two started at this history conference I participated in at Harvard in March 2013. A time when Dalian Wanda, a film studio founded by the Chinese real estate tycoon Wang Jianling, turned beleaguered major US theater chain AMC, which he had acquired in May a year before 2012 to profit. Let's go to check out some of those dates. Now, in May the following year, Wanda announced that the company would grow its business globally, including expanding into the European market. And then by September 2013, Wang Jianling had become China's richest person. The same month, Leonardo DiCaprio walked red carpet as one of Wang's guests of honor at Wanda's ceremony, announcing a 4.9 billion Qingdao movie studio. Xie Bong Isaacs, the president of the Academy of Motion Picture Science, Arts and Sciences, was also present at Wanda's ceremony. Wang Jianling kind of predicted at the opening that China's film market would become the world's biggest in 5 years. And fast forward to 2020, the COVID pandemic would shut down the global film market. And as the American film industry struggled, China managed to reboot its film market during the second part of 2020, while shutting out Hollywood pictures, making 2020 one of the world's one of the worst year for Hollywood in China. And the same year, China officially overtook North America as the world's largest market. Wang's prediction was off only by 2 years. And then in March 2021, an article from the South China Morning Post reported the dwindling appeal of US entertainment programs among the younger generation of Chinese. And by June 2021, Wanda had largely retreated from the film industry, film business overseas, having sold most of its shares in AMC amidst the theater chain's steep revenue decline as a result of the COVID lockdown in the US. And Wanda made a decidedly inward turn, returning to its home turf. And by fall 2021, you know, thanks to a sabbatical back home in New York, and I was finally able to wrap up the book. And by then, the Chinese and American films have grown far apart and become more distinct from each other, even as the two industries have become ever more entangled. The collusion in business had continued, but the government, media, and public scrutiny from both sides made film collaboration a hazardous proposition. And my book basically parallels in broad stroke the origins and evolutions of the American and Chinese film industries, and both of which had roots in commercial operations. Though the American film pioneers were mostly tied to the distribution exhibition businesses, while the Chinese film pioneers were a mixture of theater, cinema lovers, and also merchants. Early film industry in China pretty much emulated the American style studio model. Even the censorship regimen progressed in a similar fashion in China and the US. And in fact, during the Republic era, the Chinese consulted HACCP, the American censorship code, in devising its own censorship regulations. The paths diverged only during the Mao era, as the People's Republic of China forcefully converted the Chinese film industry from a private and decentralized model to a Soviet-style centralized and a state-subsidized model, while banishing Hollywood from China altogether. And as I capture the major developmental phase of both industries, I pay special attention to the ups and downs of Sino-Hollywood entanglement, and which have been under the sway of the larger political, economic culture and cultural forces, much of these in the name of national interests. And speaking of national interest, I begin the book by unpacking the linkage between film industries and national governments. Within the context of Sino-US, it actually took some lobbying effort from the film industries for both the Chinese and the US governments to see the potential of motion picture for cultural influence, political persuasion, and consumer product promotion in the case of the US, but not so much in China. And once caught on, and both governments sought to capitalize on the affective power of cinema, and film does emerge to be one of the most glamorous and effective effective influencers, to use the modern lexicon. But the nature of the relationship between the industry and the government differs. The US government, up until the last US president came along, President Donald Trump came along, functioned mostly as a facilitator for the growth and international expansion of the American film industry, as it relished Hollywood's charm in showcasing the American lifestyle, pop culture, and consumer products. the Chinese governments, both the KMT and the CCP, were more meddlesome, prone to content regulation, but offered little financial relief to the film industry under the shadow of Hollywood, which consistently outperformed the Chinese film on China's domestic turf. Hollywood's dominance in China during the Republic era put the beleaguered Nanjing government on defense. As captured in the book, the Chinese reacted passive-aggressively towards Hollywood's popularity and American films' rampant China offense on the image front, you know, for which Hollywood it was guilty as charged, though nothing personal, as the big boy Hollywood was an equal opportunity offender. Or defender who managed to kind of cavalierly offend images of many nation states as it crashed their domestic markets. The People's Republic era would usher in a decidedly more progressive and proactive approach in eradicating the US cultural presence, indeed banning Hollywood films altogether during the Mao era. So my book basically charts four major phases in the Sino-Hollywood relation dating back to 1897, the year when the first batch of US motion pictures appeared in China, being brought over by James Ricotton, seen here, an American photographer from New Jersey, the birthplace of the American film industry. Ricotton screened a few Edison films, including Tsar Nicholas II, visiting Paris at a tea house in Shanghai. And he continued as a photographer in China and actually recorded the Boxer Rebellion of 1900. Hollywood came and Hollywood conquered, not just in China, but all over the world. Just how dominant was Hollywood during the olden days? Now, most of us think about the international film trade in terms of how many domestic films are released each year and what share of total box office receipts go to foreign versus domestic films, so on and so forth. However, in the early days, a more common way to keep a tabs on the film trade was to simply tally up the total length of the so-called exposed films each year. A raw measure to be sure, but one that served well enough in its time. In one of the books, a film scholar, Carrie Seagrave, goes to this early record to compare length. And the numbers reveal an interesting footage race that began with entrants from around the world competing on a very kind of a leveling playground until World War I intervened. The war hobbled film production nearly everywhere except the United States, allowing Hollywood to take the lead and run with it. In China, Hollywood took up to 80% of the market during the Republic era. And the founding of the PRC in 1949 and the outbreak of the Korean War in 1950 led to a wholesale ban on all things American, including Hollywood pictures, though the ban was not without trepidation from the party leaders who had private misgivings about an outright ban, with the concern that such might provoke an outcry from fans of Hollywood pictures, particularly in China's cosmopolitan urban center, such as Shanghai. And it was a high time, of course, for the party to woo the urban dwellers for the purpose of maintaining stability in the newly founded People's Republic of China. And the Yankee pictures served as pacifiers. One twist is that, though the official ban on Hollywood would last throughout the Mao era, there were actually quite a number of Hollywood-led Western films circulating unofficially among the party's top entourage under the direct control of Madame Mao, the wife of Chairman Mao. And these films are called internal reference films, some of which were lavishly dubbed in Chinese under the auspice of Madame Mao, who was a one-time movie actress in Shanghai and a closeted fan of Hollywood classics. In the early 1970s, there were these semi-hushed overnight marathon screenings of internal reference films at government, including military compounds, as incentives for people to sit through the multi-day marathon party meetings. And so popular were these films, the evening screenings from time to time run up to 7 and 8 hours straight. A practice that way predate what we now call binge watch. Let me go back to the previous slide, actually. The third phase saw the triumphant return of Hollywood in the mid-1990s with the overture from China, and at a time when China's economic reform forced the previously state-subsidized film industry to earn commercial living. Far from soft landing, the industry stumbled, failing to make marketable pictures. Movie theaters were shedding patrons to emergent competing entertainment options. Hollywood was called back to resuscitate the Chinese film market. And Hollywood came, Hollywood performed to the task. And China revived the film industry by returning to the good old Hollywood model. The reversal of the Soviet model took some laborious effort, including kind of getting reacquainted with the Hollywood trade book. Hollywood films were permitted to officially re-enter China by the late 1970s, when the country reopened its door to the outside. But the revenue sharing blockbuster films were not allowed until the mid-1990s. And upon returning, Hollywood soon swept the Chinese market, quickly attracting audiences back to the theaters. One point I emphasize in my book is that Hollywood films have triggered simultaneously fascination, apprehension, resistance, and also competition during both China's Republic era and the post-Mao People's Republic era. And admiration for the sheer kind of allure and the market prowess of Hollywood pictures, resistance for Hollywood's perceived historical injustice to the China image and also to China's, to Hollywood's market dominance. And in the past few years, competition and effort to draft Hollywood into serving China's interest, particularly China's global image campaign, notwithstanding the most recent chatter about decoupling. And the post-Mao return of Hollywood triggered the same euphoria mixed with fear and loathing. As the Chinese film industry grew stronger, China pushed back, using a number of restrictive measures to reduce Hollywood's China presence. As reflected in this chart, American-made films accounted for more than 48% of China's box office revenue 10 years ago in 2012. The number came down to 36% in 2016, and the number plummeted to only 12.3% of China's box office revenue by 2021. As China took over its own kind of domestic market, or rather took back its own domestic market, Hollywood's post-Mao honeymoon seems to have come to an end. There have been signs that Hollywood is pivoting away from films containing China elements, including casting talents of Chinese heritage, particularly after the failure of these films. And I only include three of them, there are more. In securing China releases, you know, these films are banned in China for a variety of reasons. The question frequently asked is whether Hollywood can afford to simply walk away from the Chinese market, right? And the release of the Tom Cruise franchise, Top Gun 2, over the summer is an interesting case to observe for Hollywood without the Chinese market and funding. The film Top Gun 2 was actually initially co-financed by the Chinese internet company Tencent. A trailer in 2019 saw our hero Maverick wearing a bomber jacket with a patch that was missing the image of the ROC flag seen in the first film, which caused a stir. Paramount Pictures was called out for pandering to China. However, the ROC flag was restored in the film's final version released this year, just over the past summer. So what happened between 2019 and 2022? Well, amidst the deteriorating Sino-US relation, Tencent withdrew its funding by late 2019. And Paramount has since came to terms with the impossibility of getting a China green light for a film showcasing the US military. With the pressure of the China market gone, the studio promptly restored the ROC flag. The film had its wide release globally, excluding China, grossing $1 billion in box office and counting, actually, and to become the highest grossing film of 2020. The pace of Top Gun 2 suggests that Hollywood can survive without the Chinese market if it recalibrates its blockbuster budget and box office expectations and make it do with a final tally without the China revenue. In fact, owing to the domestic performance of Top Gun, Maverick, another blockbuster film, Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, both of which were denied China release, North America is poised to be on track to reclaim the world's biggest theatrical movie market in 2022, as we speak this year. And some in the United States foresee a return to a business model where the US studios make mid-budget movies targeting at American adults rather than mega-budget films aiming to please foreign markets. As Sony Bunch puts it, film in which Chinese filmmakers make films for Chinese audiences and in which American films make films for Western audiences isn't worst thing that could happen. Sony Bunch might have a point. I, for one, am kind of rather jaded by Hollywood's theme park-like superhero franchising movies, seeing as the winning formula for the global market. And I have Martin Scorsese by my side. Some of you probably have come across this article where Martin Scorsese expressed his displeasure of these Marvel superhero movies. So maybe, just maybe, the decoupling will help to rein in the Marvels and the alike. Maybe the loss of the Chinese market will allow the studios to tone down budget and make a few more A-class films of genuine human touch and domestic relevance. In China, apart from blockbuster Hollywood films, Chinese filmmakers have been making mainstream commercial films for Chinese audiences that are enormously popular in China. And to better check the pulse of Chinese cinema, or of China for that matter, and for those China watchers, it behooves us to actually pay attention to the popular Chinese mainstream films instead of lightly dismiss them in the kind of purity contest for artistic quality or political provocation. Over the years, the Chinese film industry has cultivated a unique brand of holiday movies, for instance, the so-called Chinese New Year films that have resonated with the Chinese audiences. And chapter 7 of my book captures some of these films. Lost in Russia, for instance, see the post here, Lost in Russia, the Chinese name of this movie is called Jiu Ma, meaning Mother Awkward, a Chinese New Year film about a shared road trip between an adult son and an Asian woman was extremely popular when it came out in 2020. The film was initially slated for theatrical release as a New Year celebration film on January 24, 2020, but COVID intervened and it was instead released the following day on the internet for free streaming, a welcome respite, you know, for Chinese viewers who are stuck home in home confinement. Lost in Russia was streamed within 2 days, more than 600 million times. So really extremely popular film. And the Spring Festival, of course, was its focus on kinship, family reunion, family gathering is a kind of opportune time for a sentimental film about family bonding and overcoming the generational gap. The film features Ivan, the adult son, who kind of grudgingly and by accident boards a Russian-bound Trans-Siberian train to accompany her strong-willed mother on a trip to Moscow to fulfill her previously foiled dream of performing with her choir at the Moscow Grand Theater. The journey gives mother and son plenty of time to bicker and also bond as he deals with his kind of own disintegrating marriage. The character Ivan was played by Xu Zeng, a popular TV comedian who came to prominence when he directed his first two previous Lost films, Lost in Thailand, Sing Here, Lost in Thailand, and Lost in Hong Kong. Two happy-go-lucky role movies that kind of celebrate tourism, self-discovery, and human bonding. It was noting that the Lost in Hong Kong, the middle one, pays homage to the golden age of filmmaking in Hong Kong. And the road trip serves as an occasion for Xu Zeng to showcase his knowledge and also affection for Canton Pop, including Hong Kong cinema, which was trendy and ubiquitous to Xu's generation coming of age in the PRC. But the timing could not be worse. The film is about adventures, or rather misadventures, of a group of Chinese tourists in Hong Kong. At the time, Hong Kong was overwhelmed by the Chinese tourists, and it was shot in Hong Kong during the Umbrella Movement. If Hong Kong was a misfire 5 years earlier, amidst the tension, Russia was a nice respite in 2020 amidst kind of escalating Sino-US tension and during the kind of short window of opportunity before the Ukraine war. The film pays tribute to Russia for the kind of nostalgic glow of music and songs of the Soviet era, which form part of Xu's upbringing and his mother's kind of memory and imagination. The Russia in their imagination is the one kind of they were exposed to during Mao's era through Soviet films. I wanted to share with you a couple of scenes here. So the first thing captures well the kind of a mother and son bonding and the Soviet link of the mother's generation. The entire story is just a road movie. The entire story is about how they overcome various obstacles trying to make way to Moscow to get to the Moscow Grand Theater to perform, right? So they were constantly delayed by a number of obstacles. And so in this thing, they were just so exhausted, they were taking a break. You know, they need to cross large kind of frozen lake, but they were just kind of take a little short break. And earlier during the story, we were made aware that Ivan's mother and father had divorced. Let's actually go play the thing. Hopefully it plays.
What? 当年你爸为我放的那部电影就叫《一万的童年》。
So turns out she's name Ivan comes from the Soviet war film, anti-war film, Ivan's Childhood, which Jean-Paul Sartre actually praised as one of the most beautiful film he had ever seen. The film tells the experiences of an orphaned boy named Ivan during World War II. It was made during the Khrushchev thaw, and it examined kind of human cost of war and refused to glorify the war experience during the Stalin era. And the film actually won Golden Lion at the Venice Film Festival in 1962. And it was selected as the Soviet entry for the best foreign language films at the 36th Academy Awards, but was not accepted as a nominee. It made its way to China as one of the international internal reference films for criticism during Mao's era. So there's a kind of interesting kind of entangled relationship with Russia here. Now, I wanted to show you the climatic scene of the murder performing. You know, belatedly made into the Moscow theater, and she got onto the stage. She started to perform initially, kind of tentative. But later, since she kind of relaxed, that she started to sing. And so, what she was singing is a widely circulated Russian song during the Soviet era by the name "Oh, the Kalina Flowers Are in Bloom," about a young girl's love for a boy. The song comes from the Soviet film Cossacks of Tkuba, and it was performed in the original film by a group of female singers on stage, what you'll be seeing eventually. A group of choir members got onto the stage to perform together with the mother, and the song was extremely popular in China during Mao's era. You know, again, this is a climatic scene, and the mother got on. She's essentially also singing her own life, right? So we learn a bit and piece about the broken marriage and the first love and so on and so forth. Okay, so the climax and it leads to a quick resolution. The son and the mother return to Shanghai and kind of life goes on, so on and so forth. Now, by making a film paying homage to Russia in 2020, she actually lucked out. Can you imagine, you know, the film being made today amidst the Russia's invasion of Ukraine? And our film reminiscing about encounters in Xinjiang, right? So earlier during that sequence, the mother talked about how she met her future husband in Xinjiang. So this actually only further attests to the politics of filmmaking and film reception. Now, the overriding motif in the Lost franchise is the constant notion of self-discovery, which is achieved through characters embarking on journeys in pairs. Relationships evolve over time and eventually transform both characters. The main characters in the Love Trilogy, the Lost Trilogy, are seen as trapped in China's full-blown capitalist rat race, where success is defined by money and power. The male lead is forced to take stock of his own core values as he tries to balance the competing demands of money, power, career and marriage, or human connections. You know, a kind of familiar theme of greed versus love, happiness that have been explored in numerous Hollywood films since the dawn of cinema. Xu's films captured well the existential crisis of Chinese elites whose wealth, mobility, and pseudo-intellectual superiority fall short of bringing happiness. As the contemporary Chinese bon boy has it, there was no money, but hope is, but hope in the past. There was no money, but hope in the past, but there's plenty of money, but no hope now. So it's interesting that films like this kind of resonated among the Chinese audiences. To wrap up, initially, kind of initiated almost a decade ago, my book started out by invoking somewhat facetiously the term courtship. Now it's been kind of widely used to describe what I saw as a kind of a fitful relationship that, however, tentative and antagonistic at times, brought two willing partners to the negotiating table for the common pursuit of prosperity and happiness, measured by the tangible box office receipts and by the less tangible notion of cultural influence. And my focus is on the kind of machinations behind the art and artifice, including the economy and politics of filmmaking. The Sino-Hollywood relation was initially more of an apprenticeship, as the two parties were by no means equal in finance, technology, and popular appeal, while guilty of flooding the global market with its brand of entertainment at expenses of local cultural industries. Hollywood has always, you know, peddled softly with plenty of charm and delight, though not always with taste. It has nevertheless won the hearts and minds of the Chinese audiences. Hollywood's global megastars in the likes of, say, Tom Cruise, can make even the parochial American patriotism look very cool, cosmopolitan, and even universal. On the other hand, the business of filmmaking is booming in China, but not necessarily the cross-cultural appeal and global recognition of the Chinese state-sponsored films. Oops. When it comes to the competition of rival propaganda war films, Top Gun's Maverick has earned $760 million outside of North America without a China release. But its counterpart, the Chinese domestic blockbuster Battle at Lake Changjin II, has brought in less than 1 million from beyond China's borders. So numbers do not lie. Though it continues to lag in global popularity and recognition, China's robust domestic market has emboldened the Chinese film industry to challenge Hollywood at a time when the US domestic politics put the US studios' China dealings under scrutiny. But I am not forecasting the end of Hollywood in China. China has both the market to sell and the cash for investment. It would be hard for dealmakers to simply walk away despite the scrutiny from the lawmakers and the media. Deals will be made, but more surreptitiously and in a much more low-key fashion. Just in August, later summer, James Cameron kind of treated executives from China Film Group to a screening of footage from his new Avatar project in progress at the time. And interestingly, it was China Daily that broke the news. And of course, James Cameron's movies were enormously popular in China, including Titanic and the first Avatar. And only a few days ago, we learned that the new Avatar has secured the China release, which is this is a real kind of a real case for Hollywood studios now to gain this kind of access in China. So in the end, the cycle of boom and bust remains the norm in the movie business. the lackluster reception of recent Hollywood films might only be a phase. It is really hard to gauge the actual Chinese audience's reaction to Hollywood films these days, kind of given the increasingly restricted access kind of imposed by the Chinese government. And, you know, governments, US and in Chinese, tend to underestimate the intelligence of the audiences. Audiences do gravitate towards films of personal connections, not necessarily films promoted by the governments or the studios. So that said, my book nevertheless serves as a swan song to an era of Hollywood fetish in China and vice versa, not the end of Hollywood in China, but the Hollywood fetish in China. The relationship is going through a period of a reset, and however you want to call it, maybe a midlife crisis. But all this is contingent upon the larger kind of Sino-US relation, of course. And so the main takeaway is that the situation continues to be fluid, and history more often than not goes kind of cyclical and tends to repeat itself. So the kind of pull and push dynamic will continue. I think that I should stop here and to kind of let's hear some comments or questions.
Professor Zhu, is very interesting. You did bring in Top Gun Maverick into the conversation, our most recent thing, that sort of happened right after your book got published. Is this like a one-time fluke? is it Tom Cruise's stardom, his charisma that drew people to the box office everywhere else? I mean, I can understand if American patriotism caused, the film not to be released in China, right? But in the future, I mean, do you see other films? How you talk about a specific formula, right? They have to recalculate and stuff like that. But like, is it the star? Is it the topic? The film, right? Yeah, and then you also show three Asian American films, right? Like Shang-Chi, right? The film directed by the director, right?
Chloe Chan. Yeah.
That was sort of looked down upon after she won the Oscars, right? And then even before the pandemic, sort of Asian Americans in film being shown internationally, Crazy Rich Asians, the big box office hit United States, but then failed terribly in China due to certain tastes by the Chinese audience, right? And so, these people, the stars are not Chinese, and not handsome enough. For Shang-Chi, the reason a lot of people complain Simu Liu wasn't handsome enough, for reasons not to watch that particular film. But I mean, how can Hollywood itself, bank on a successful film without China's sort of like box office at all? I mean, James Cameron, I can understand, because at that particular time, a lot of people in China, the box office, counted on it, right? And then 3D technology at that time, he pushed it, and there were a lot of box office like for the proceeds, right, on 3D showings and stuff like that. So I mean, I foresee Avatar 2 being successful there, but how can other films sort of like tap in and then get successful?
Well, like I said, so one way of, the Hollywood only has two choices, right? You either recalibrate, your box office expectations. So if you, counting out China, so that's one way of calculating it. And so that would affect the amount of budget you can put in, right? Because Hollywood films increasingly receive 65% of revenue from overseas market. In the past few decade or so, the Chinese market brought in real actual revenue to Hollywood. So Hollywood has a choice to make. You either make films that just completely sanitize without any elements that will cause a problem in China, and therefore you can continue your honeymoon there, or you do the story you want to do, but just leave it for the fate and see if you can open or not in China. So yeah, I mean, there's some choices to make, and there are certainly films that they have nothing to do with politics, right? These films should open big. The reason Top Guns wasn't able to do that, partly because, yeah, it is a film about celebrating the American military, right? So really, depending on, you know, how you calculate that and whether you really want to. So for instance, for Avatar, the new Avatar, right? That's a huge amount of budget invested in making this film. And given that there is no actual thematical or stylistic problem for this film to be distributed in China, so therefore this film can have its Chinese release. And so that means the James Cameron, his production company, will receive a windfall. So it's not a sad formula, but there are some big decisions to make for studio when they, you know, make these films for China market.
Yeah, you did bring up the Battle of Changjin, not doing as well outside internationally. a couple of years ago, The Wandering Earth, the massive box office in China itself, and then Netflix bought it and then put it on their streaming platform, but then didn't promote it as much, even though they spent money on it, right? How can China fine-tune itself to get a outside international audience to, you know, consume their, you know, cinema more broadly?
Again, I think you have
Yeah.
So in comparison to Hollywood, which kind of receives 65% of the revenue from overseas market, China, to the best, only receive up to 5%. So, you're right. So even Indian films, they can actually come to kind of receive 25 to 30% of revenues from overseas, right? So China is really way behind in garnering global recognition. How they can bypass that? They need to get over politics. They need to make films that has a genuine universal appeal. So when you look at The Wandering Earth, right? Wandering Earth is really takes a shot at America. It barely recognized America at all. So we're talking about, this is a huge disaster. The world is about to end, right? Just the sun or the whatever is about to collude, right? And so China is the one who is rallying. China is, you know, kind of an appear to be the leader, right, of this group of people who are trying hard to avert a disaster, right? So America is kind of a very lightly mentioned and discarded. So this kind of sentiment, I doubt it will sit well, and also it probably is not really realistic too, right? Beyond the Chinese border. And so I think China needs to get over this kind of jingoistic, ethnocentric narrative. Allowing in the films that has genuine kind of universal human connection to emerge. And not that Chinese filmmakers have never made these films. They did in the 1990s. There's films that To Live, right? Film My Concubine, and so on and so forth, right? But these are not the films that's promoted by the Chinese government. But there are certain films, though, like these films I talked about in my book, Chapter 7, these are enormously popular, but these films kind of deal with very local issues, right? So it carries the so-called cultural discount. And so, which means that because when it crosses border, it bears less relevance to the rest of the audience. So therefore it's hard for people to relate. So, and also there's a language barrier too, right? Because international audiences in general, they just don't want to watch subtitle films, and especially American audiences. And there's also a particular way of storytelling in China that's pretty much rooted in the Chinese literary tradition. And it's kind of slow and wild sprawling, there's not much of narrative economy and efficiency and so on and so forth. So it's just different kind of film aesthetics. So these all are part of the kind of barrier for the Chinese industry to cross over. But ultimately, I think really they need to get over, move beyond this kind of a competitive stand, making some genuine, you know, a film of genuine human, you know, kind of can connect with people at an emotional level. And I don't see that in these huge propagandistic blockbuster films coming out of China. Blockbuster in terms of budget.
One of our attendees, Joyce Kyokam, says that she's actually helped the work on the Wandering Earth sequel that is being developed right now, right? Ryan Smith has a question. Do you think Hollywood's desire for the Chinese market contributed to the death of the big budget comedy films? Is it often said that comedies are the hardest film genre to translate?
So the question is a nod? I didn't hear it very clearly. So there aren't there many comedy films.
Yeah. What's a recent comedy film, American comedy film that has like massive success recently in China that you can happen to recall?
You're right. I mean, he's right. So the comedies is a, you know, it's a very specific to a particular culture. You know, humors don't translate well. Although it's hard to say these days, you know, have TikTok, you know, all these kind of snippets of comedies, they translate well, or the anime and so on and so forth. But largely humors are very locally kind of a bound, right? For instance, you know, if you watch Seinfeld, right, people even outside of New York might not get some of the humor, right? So yeah, certainly that's, you know, comedy does not sell overseas, but comedy does not need a Chinese market. Because these are all the mid-budget, small-budget films. They're not blockbuster action, you know, Marvels and superheroes. So they're fine. They can survive without the Chinese market. And there are, I think some humors do also kind of get crossover. But in general, yeah, it is. That's the case.
Yeah, I think one example is, once again, Crazy Rich Asians, some of that particular humor.
So, that's interesting. Okay, no, Crazy Rich Asian, and I don't think it's necessarily not that funny, and I wouldn't call it as a comedy. You know, the reason Crazy Rich Asian does not sell well, and I kind of talked about that in my book, is because I think it's a false equivalence to kind of identify Asian American, a Chinese American. With the Chinese in China, because the experience are vastly different, you know, the cultural backgrounds are different, and so these issues, you know, American filmmakers explore in these Asian American focused film, which is very rare actually, might not be relevant to the, you know, the issue of discrimination, you know. Struggle, diversity, and so on and so forth. These are not the issues that the Chinese in China actually understand and can relate. So that's one thing. Kind of relevance is one thing. Identification is one thing. The other thing is, if you talk about Crazy Rich Asians, have you seen Crazy Rich Chinese? So in other words, the Crazy Rich Asians are not exotic enough for the Chinese, because the riches in China are even crazier. so it doesn't look so too exotic or outlandish. And to actually have, you know, that kind of effect, oh, wow, that's funny, right? I'd be actually interested in this new movie. What was it called? The title is so long, Everything, Everywhere.
Yes. Everything, what Everywhere, All at Once. Yes.
that's a mouthful. And that's a kind of interesting, you know, film. But of course, you know, it's also very specifically pertaining to Asian American experience, right? So, you know, I would be very surprised if people in China will kind of massively embrace this film. But on the other hand, this film actually resonates, you know, with a younger population, younger people, because then, you know, the certain parts of it that talks about the generational gap, right? So that has kind of a universal appeal too. So I'm pretty sure, you know, the Chinese youngsters having the same issue, right? How to negotiate with their parents for their expectations, stress, and pressure, and so on and so forth.
Did the film get a Chinese release?
I don't think so.
Okay.
But there aren't that many. So last year, there was only 17 films were released in China. But we have to verify it. Don't take my word for it. We'll okay. check and see if this film has been released in China.
What has been the reception of your book so far? In China and over here, you know, discussing their relationship.
That's interesting. Well, because the book just came out this summer, right, mm-hmm. in July. It kind of takes time, but I know that review will be coming out, and I know one review will be coming out at New York Times book review, and YRB, and in January I was told, review is coming out. In terms of China, it's interesting because I received notes, emails, and so on and so forth from some people, a few people in China that actually have pirated a copy in China. So this young lady contacted me basically saying, okay, I really like your book and I saw this. And I said, well, how did you get the book, right? So do you actually can purchase the book from Amazon to have it shipped to China? And she said, no, so it's available in this ebook site Z something, and then the next thing I know, and there was a massive kind of a crackdown on the site. The site was taken off, apparently. Mm. So it'll be interesting to see. I don't know. I don't know what the official reaction from China is. I really don't. You know, the book really kind of take a historical view on the Sino-US relationship. It describes, but it does not, it's critical, but it does not denounce in the same way. But nevertheless, it is taking, quite a critical view of some of the practices, by the Chinese regulators. And it also kind of or reveals too that the kind of historical a connection between the film industry and the U.S. government. So I would say it's a just sort of a objective, balanced approach.
Lisa Sun says, thank you very much, Professor Zhu, for your analysis of Hollywood China. Wish you great success. If you haven't already talked about this topic so far, they are a film fanatic and watch film both in English and Mandarin. Watch both English and Mandarin film. You're right that some topics do not translate well cross-border or cross-culturally. However, there seems to be an emerging sense within the younger generation that films have to speak to human issues, but also culturally authentic. So independent filmmakers are hoping to be more culturally authentic. Like to hear your thoughts on this movement about the Hollywood changing perspective. Thank you.
I guess one thing is about authentic culture, right? What was the phrase again? Culturally authentic film, right? Culturally authentic film. So yeah, more authentic. A lot of time, the barrier is not about kind of a larger emotional reactions. The barrier might just be, certain specific instance in the story that might be kind of pertaining to a particular location, kind of geopolitical dynamic that might not be easily kind of understood across the border. But on the other hand, you do have a lot of films from these minor countries, you have all these incredibly moving Iranian films, Turkish films, right? And they do translate, they're able to connect with audiences, although relatively small segment of audiences. I don't see these films, or even though they garner awards, they will never be able to open broadly. So I would say these are kind of somewhat authentic, culturally authentic film. They really address local conditions, issues, and do not pander. I think that probably is what was meant by culturally kind of authentic. So I think the other side of the coin is too that I think Hollywood should also try to make culturally authentic film instead of pandering to the international market, particularly pandering to the perceived China taste. In fact, the films that sell really well in China are not these co-produced film that has these kind of haphazard marginal China elements, right? It's the real pure Hollywood films that has nothing to do with China. And these films are the real films that actually open big in China. So that actually, attests to this notion of authentic too, because these are the real authentic Hollywood films, right? Not sure if I answered the question, but that's my thought.
Okay. If anybody does have last minute questions, you can type it in. I do want to make a little comment. It seems even though China has budget available, their special effects never seem to be up to the level of Hollywood film. It seems to be, there's this drastic, difference between the special effects, even though they hire Weta Digital to do their, special effects, there seems to be a drastic difference, you can tell. I don't know why that's the case.
Yeah, in terms of technology and techniques, and China still has a way to go. They have yet to catch up. But I'm not too concerned. I think sooner or later they are going to, because the budget is there, and they can buy off talent. They can buy off the creative team and special effects team, for that matter. But it will take some time. And whatever money can buy, eventually they can get there. The real problem is, how to tell a good story. That's not something that you can just can be transported from Hollywood, right? So that's the thing that we'll have to wait and see. I think in this regard, the less government control is the better. Right, you're gonna have to let people to have this creative juice flow freely without any concerns for political ramifications and whatnot, right? And you also have to let filmmakers to explore what they really want to explore, not just making these patriotic militant films, right? Small scale films, right? Or authentic films that are really authentic to yourself, to the filmmakers, right?
Yeah. One of our attendees, Initial AD, thanks you for this talk. Could you speak about the moment in the early 2000s when films like Hero and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon were hugely popular in the US? You probably covered this in one of your chapters. Yeah.
Interesting, but actually I did not actually cover that. I kind of mentioning in passing, I actually did not cover that. The reason being, I've been doing research on Chinese cinema for so long, 2 decades, right? And I've written about that on various occasions in the last decade or two. So I decided I'm going to move beyond that, because there's just been so much talk about, a lot of attention being paid to Heroes and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragons. And all the earlier Chinese New Wave films. So I kind of moved on. My focus on Chinese film industry, Chinese cinema, is really on the mainstream commercial films. These are kind of a middle budget, small budget film, but they speak to the Chinese audiences. And the reason I do that is thinking, if you really wanted to understand China, and you have to know what the Chinese audiences are watching, actually, right? It would be very elegant of us not just dismissing them. Oh, these just commercial affairs. Well, they're not. There's something must ticked for the audiences. So in terms of Hero and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, of course, is the first film that kind of broke out this conventional wisdom of audiences just are not receptive to the subtitle films. Guess what it did? In my audience, it becomes a sleeper hit. Right, so it just became hugely popular. When Sony distributed this film, they didn't expect this to be big, but it became big, right? And part of it, I think it's novelty too. And part of it, it's really very interesting storytelling, great. And just great, casting. Michelle Yeoh was just fantastic. And Michelle Yeoh has being in so many, you know, films, she's a real, actually a star. I think she's just as good as, you know, a lot of the Hollywood big stars. So many reasons why this film did well. Although, again, this film did not do well in China, because it defies the traditional expectation of what a martial arts film is supposed to be. So this kind of interesting kind of disconnect, right? When a film opens big in Hollywood, but it does not open big in China. So that is also the time. That's interesting, because the only film that's crossed over is these kind of kung fu martial arts film. Historically, it was the kung fu film, right? It was, you know, Hong Kong, this Shaw Studios, Gordon Harvest, that they made and distributed and promoted Bruce Lee films, right? And then Jackie Chan, you know, these are the kung fu. So the genres that pertaining native to the Chinese are kung fu, and then later on to martial arts. So Ang Lee is essentially kind of revived these old traditional genre and martial arts. And then Zhang Yimou came along riding the wave of that fever, right? So Hero came out. Although Hero received a kind of controversial, conflicting critical appraisals, right? Some said, oh, this is a fantastic film, but some said, oh, you know, this is just propagandistic, right? So again, that also just kind of, it's interesting, you know, because our just a natural aversion to any film that's coming out of China, that thinking, oh, there must be, you know, have some kind of propaganda in by nature, right? But overall, though, you can say that the kind of films that have done well caters to this particular niche genre, or sometimes I'll say it's kind of martial arts ghetto. So that's where Chinese films are, like martial arts ghetto. So you have yet to see kind of a real A-class film that can open wide internationally.
I want to thank Dr. Zhu again for a wonderful presentation. You can purchase her book, Hollywood in China, online from the New Press website for $27.99, also from Amazon and Barnes & Noble's and other book store websites. The link is available on Dr. Zhu's talk webpage. As I mentioned, Dr. Zhu has previously spoken at the Institute. You can watch some of her past talks on our website and YouTube channel. With that, enjoy your weekend and remember to be an upstander if you see a fellow person in need. I want to thank Dr. Zhu for a great talk and see you soon. Thank you, everybody,
thank you.
For joining us tonight. Have a good rest, Dr. Zhu.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.